One, two, three. That's real popular these days. A style of bass playing that has survived the 60s, 70s, 80s, surviving the 90s. And it's called pumping and plucking, slap bass, chopper bass, you name it, it's been called many things. But the point is, it's playing with your thumb fingers thumping and plucking style. Now it got started some years back. My mother and I were working together, see. We were playing nightclubs. And for a while, we had guitar and piano and the drummer. And I would play the organ, bass pedals with my foot, see. Sounded pretty good. But the organ was so old that it broke down, you see. And we couldn't get that old thing fixed. So it kind of sounded kind of empty not having a bottom. So what we did is I went down and rented an old St. George bass. And I said, well, I'll just do this for a little while, so there's no need of me trying to play like this like everybody else, you know. I said, nah, that don't even feel good to me, you know. So I just thought I'd play like this because I thought I'd go back to guitar. While anyway, but the old organ was so old it never could get fixed, and I got stuck on the bass. So after a while, it was just me and Mom's, no drummer. And to make up for not having a bass drum, I would thump the strings just like this. Remember, I didn't have a bass drum, so I did this. Make up for not having a snare drum now. Cause see, I was used to playing with that backbeat. Got that pow, pow, pow. So I didn't have that. So now I had to thump and pluck. Was this lady used to come down and hear me and Mom's playing. She was also a fan of Sly Stone, who was on the radio at the time. She told him to come down and check out this bass player before you start your group. Check him out. I think you might like him. So he came on down to the club, and he heard me doing my thumping and plucking, asked me to join his group. The group turned out to be Sly and the Family Stone. And through that group, my thumping and plucking became popular all over the world with songs like this. Dance to the music. One, two, three.
Dance to the music.
Remember that? Well, it was a hit record. And through that song and many others, my style became popular. That wasn't the only one now. See, because what happened is after that was a hit, we went back in the studio, and I got a chance to thump and pluck on a song like this. Thank you, two, three, ah. Thumping and plucking was popular. But the next time we went back in the studio, I got a chance to do something that we thought was pretty unique. I got a chance to thump the whole song. In fact, the note never changed on the whole record. It's a song that went like this. another hit record on our hands. And I got a chance to thump like that the whole song. I love it. Then later on, I started my group, Grand Central Station. And I got a chance to thump and pluck some more on songs like this. Pow! One, two, three, ah! Hello, my name is Larry Graham. We'd like to welcome you to the Larry Graham Super Chopper Bass Thump and Pluck Slap Technique video. Or whatever you choose to call it. I'm sure that some of the future generations will add other names to that list. This video will talk about, things that you maybe might want to know about. For example, how did my style of playing get started? The thumping and plucking style, that's what I call it. And we'll talk a little bit about that, the history of it. We'll talk also about the different effects that I use when I'm playing on stage and on record. We'll even get into different patterns and rhythms and the interaction between the drums and the bass, which is very important. Right now, I'd like to introduce you to someone that's very important to me in my life. I'd like to introduce you to Sunshine. Say hi. Hello. This is Sunshine. This is actually a bass that was made by Moon, M-O-O-N. And what happened briefly, to tell you a little story, is when I came to Japan the first time, they said that we'd like to make a bass for you. And they brought me the various types of basses that they make. And I picked out the various things that I liked about the basses, added some things that I didn't have in a bass that I owned, things that I had picked up from other basses I had played, putting all those different combinations and elements together. They said, by the end of the tour, we'll have the bass ready for you. I said, really? All these things you're going to do by the end of this tour? They said, yeah, hi. I said, okay. So they did it. And this is the end product. Now, we've taken it a little bit further. This is the four-string funk bass, but here is the five-string version right here, the Larry Graham model. Say hello.
Hello.
This is Sunshine and Moonshine, the dynamic duo. So we are going to get together now and play some things for you. And again, we'd like to extend a warm welcome to you. And thank you so much for taking out the time to want to learn more about the Larry Graham thumping and plucking super chopper bass funk technique, or whatever else you choose to call it. What I'd like to do now is take a few minutes and explain to you my style of playing the bass, my thumping and plucking, or as we might want to call it, the super chopper bass thumping and plucking slap style. Or something like that, okay? So, I'm going to explain it to you. First of all, the most important ingredient, which you need first, and most importantly, is a thumb. It doesn't have to be exactly like this one, but just a thumb would do. Second most important ingredient, you need a finger to pluck with. And then you need a bass. And I'm going to show you how to use it, okay? Now, for example, if we are playing a song like I Believe in You, notice the plucking and the thumping, and that the way you attack the strings is important. Because if you just hit the strings lightly, you won't quite get that bite, that attack, that drive you need to really make it sound the way it should, like, or plucking like, as opposed to, you see, you gotta have that attack, that bite on it. Check it out, let me just do it, and then that way you'll understand a lot better, and then we'll talk about it some more. A little song like, I Believe in You. Everything you do. Did you notice the plucking, how when you pluck it hard, you get that snap, it's like a different effect. And when you thump hard, see, you can't get that sound just going, or it has to be. See, because the strings, when it snaps back, it has that funk attack, snap. You know what I'm saying? Hey, that's a new word, huh? Funk attack, snap, snap. Yeah, I think we put that in the category, right? But there's another song we're gonna go into that demonstrates the importance of the interaction between the bass and the drums. It's a song called Got to Go Through It to Get to It, and in this particular song, after I came up with the bass line, I had to then create a drum line that would kind of like act in harmony with the bass line. Let me show you what I mean. First, let me just do a couple of bars by myself. I've got to go through it to get to it without drums. And then I'll show you how important you find the right little spaces to add the drum licks, okay? Check it out. One, two, three. Notice just the drums. Nice. Now, notice the bass, just me, by myself. And if you listen to this, then we'll have drums come in and see what it sounds like together. Notice. Now, if you notice, there's not a lot of room when you listen just to the bass pattern, because I'm playing so much. So you have to really find the right spot. Otherwise, instead of music, you come up with garbage or garbage. So notice, it's very important you put the right licks in the right place. So now you see about the thumping and the plucking and the pulling the strings and so forth. So what we're going to get into now is talking about the pedals, the effect pedals that I use on stage and on records. First, we'll talk a little bit about the fuzz. Now, this particular fuzz pedal is called the Juggernaut Fuzz. Now, the reason I like this particular fuzz pedal is because it lets you have a lot of bottom while at the same time you can have some fuzz effect as well. The first time that I'm aware of that fuzz was used on record was when I was with the group Sly and the Family Stone, and as I played earlier, Dance to the Music. Well, that was the first song that featured fuzz on bass. I'm going to play a little bit more of that song, but notice the fuzz and how it's being used on this particular song, okay? Dance to the Music. One, two, three! Bottom so that the dancers just won't hide. Now, we're going to move over to another pedal. This particular pedal is called the Jet Phase. Of course, I have a few other names for it because it's bad, I think. And it's a company that really they should be making them now. I don't know if they do, because this is so old. We call it, it's not old, it's antique. See, when it's old and good, it's antique. So this is another one of my antique pedals, the Jet Phaser. And I'm going to give you a little sample of what this pedal does. I use this live as well as in the studio too. And let me just show you a little bit. One, two! Yeah. kept making that pedal. That's my jet phase. Now, we're going to move over to, I affectionately call this pedal Bigfoot, but it's really an octave divider. And this particular one, it has a ringer mode on it, a little ringer and stabilizer thing. But notice how you can use it for like heavy accents, like when you want to go bong, da, bong, da, bong. That's why I call it Bigfoot. It's like you got a great big fat foot about size 29 stepping on something going bong, da, bong, da, bong, da, da, bong. Check it out. One, two, three, ah! Well, the way I actually got into the thumping and plucking, as I said earlier, I ended up playing the bass out of necessity, and I didn't think I was going to be a bass player. Eventually, I thought I'd go back to being a guitar player. So I didn't get into playing the bass the way everybody else was playing it, which we might call the correct style, the overhand style playing. Like this. I didn't get into learning that because I'm thinking I'm going back to guitar anyway. So let me just play it the way I feel comfortable. So I would play with my fingers and with my thumb. After a period of time, we didn't have a drummer anymore. It was just my mother and I, just bass and piano. So now to make up for not having that bass drum playing in the background, I would thump the strings. I would thump with my thumb, and to make up for not having that backbeat, I would pluck with my finger. So after a while, I got, you know, pretty good at this thumping and plucking thing. It was a strange way of playing the bass, but it was getting the job done. It was like out of necessity. And again, it didn't bother me to do that because it was temporary. But as time passed, months and then years, because I was 15 at the time I started doing that, the thumping and plucking, and I never even thought that one day it would be a style of playing the bass that would influence bass players all over the world. That was the farthest thing from my mind. But that's the way it turned out. So what we're going to talk about now is the various rhythms and techniques. For example, we'll talk about the slide technique, the left hand grip. We'll talk a little bit about dynamics, okay, because that's very important. And also thumping up and down. See, earlier we talked about just thumping, like with everyday people, I was thumping down. But we're going to talk about thumping up and down, okay? Also, there's been some songs that I've played where I like to use my finger as a pick, because I don't like to really use a pick. So I like to use my finger as if it were a pick, because it gives a very unique sound. For example, check out this sound.
Thank you.
That's the LG pick. Now we're going to talk about another style. There's a lot of names you could really call it, but I call it slide bass. Slide. Because I like to slide the notes, because it makes a difference when you put that slide emphasis on something as opposed to just hitting it straight like. But if you put some slide on it, it sounds like this. One, two, three, can you handle that? She wants your lips on there, can you handle that? Can you handle that? You're meeting one of those, can you handle it? Now, did you notice that when I slide, you're kind of like, you lay back a little behind the beat. You don't fall off time now. Just kind of lay back by myself. Check it out. See the slide? You know, it's kind of like. Yeah. Yeah. That just feels good all inside, you know. So we're gonna talk about another technique, okay? And it's the left hand, okay? Because a lot of times you notice what's going on with the thumb and with the fingers thumping and plucking, but sometimes you don't take note of the fact that the left hand is doing more than just moving from fret to fret, holding down notes. For example, a song like Everyday People that we played earlier. Now, notice what my left hand is doing, how I'm using it to mute the strings as well as hold down the note. And it actually plays a little rhythm of its own. Like, one, two, three, ah. Now, did you check out the left hand? Notice as I do it by myself. I'm gonna do it by myself one time and notice the left hand, how it's muting, okay? I'll slow it down a little bit. Okay, so now, you can also use that same muting technique if you were playing something more high energy. For example, on a song Higher, I use the left hand muting technique, but I also combine with that the up and down, thumbing up and down, okay? Check it out. Higher to the I'm going to go on. check out, I was going up and down. You know, that even feels good when you're playing it, you know though? You gotta do your mouth like this too, you know, your neck, you know, that's all part of it. Now, we'll talk a little bit about dynamics, because some songs, when you have bass dynamics in your pattern, it makes it sound sometimes like it might be more than one bass playing, because you got one that's thumping harder, whereas another one is plucking softer, and you kind of like put the combination together, the two different types of dynamics, and you come out with songs sounding like this. The length of his almost had you, huh? He's watching. Had. Did you notice how it's the sounds like it's two bass parts? Check this out right here. Let me do this right here. And the dynamics are important, you see, and that's what gives you the effect that it's like more than one bass. I'll slow it down. Now we're going to talk about synchronization, a big word, and it means a lot. Because, again, we talked earlier about what the drummer plays is very important, because if my bass pattern is complicated, where I'm doing a lot of synchronization, a lot of, it's like, where's the drums going to go? So it's important that you find all the little spots, the little right spots where you can put in the drums and put them there. Otherwise, like I said earlier, you come out with garbage or garbage. Okay, but notice on this song how important synchronization is, okay? Mr. Writer. One, two, and ah. Now, you notice how complicated that bass line is, right? All right, now check it out by itself without drums. Check out the bass line, and then we'll have the drum do his part. Because if you don't find them right little pockets, that's the key ingredient. finding the right little spots to drop in the drum licks. And if you can't figure it out going fast, slow it down. Go slow. And then let the drummer find or create the drum licks going slow. You can speed it up later, but see, I'm playing, remember I told you earlier that for a while I didn't have a bass drum or snare drum, so I compensate for not having a bass drum with my thumb, compensate for not having a snare with my fingers, and you can kind of hear it in this pattern without drums. That's why once you add the bass and drums, if it's not right, you'd be messed up. But check it out, check this out. Do it with me. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, check out what the drums is doing by himself, because I showed you what the bass was doing, but now listen to the drum pattern by himself, okay? And you'll see what I'm talking about, because what I'm going to do is I'm going to let him start off, and then I'm going to join him. I'm going to do it the reverse, so you can see, in case you're a drummer. You might be a drummer that want to add a bass line. Okay, so where can I put a bass line to a complicated drum pattern? You can look at it like that too. Okay, so check it out, Mr. Ryder. 2, 3, 4. Now that was some synchronization. I'm not going to sit here and tell you it's easy, but in my case, because I played drums before I played bass, it may have made it a little easier for me to find the little pockets to put that those drum licks in with the bass parts. But even if you're not a drummer, get together with your drummer, take it slow, and just do it until it's right. You know, have your tape recorder sitting by and do it slow. Then once you get it down to where the pockets feel good, speed it up. All right, we're going to go on to something else, and we're going to talk a little bit about the thumping up and down. Now, a little earlier when we were talking about the left hand technique on higher, and we was focusing in on what my left hand was doing, I was also thumping up and down. Well, see, that technique really comes to light when I use it in a song called Release Yourself. And we'll play a little bit of it, because the whole thing is to hit the string going down and up, down and up. It's kind of like a train, you know? See, that's the kind of effect it has. But check it out on Release Yourself. And again, we'll do it together, but then we'll slow it down a little bit for you, okay? Here we go. Release Yourself. 1, 2, 3, 4. Want to see it slow? You sure? How slow? Not too slow? All right. I just go a little bit slower. See lights? Hear that? Give me some slow drums, okay? 2, 3, 4. That's the up and down thumb action. Now, warning, it may hurt a little bit. Ow! But it's worth it. Now, when you get into talking about musicians that influenced me over the years and people that influenced me, whew, that's hard. You know, musicians, I think we all kind of influence each other in one way or another. It doesn't necessarily have to be a bass player influencing a bass player, or a drummer influencing a drummer, or a singer influencing. I think we kind of all affect each other. I was in a singing group when I was in junior high school, and I remember being influenced by a group called Frankie Lyman and the Teenagers. And he had this really high, beautiful voice. And this was before my voice changed. I used to sing all these Frankie Lyman songs, you know, Why Do Fools Fall in Love, with this high voice. And then I woke up one morning and my voice wasn't high anymore. Hello, good morning, Ma. So much for Frankie Lyman influence. But then also Chuck Berry had quite a few hit records out, and because I was a guitar player, you know, I would listen to him. And a guitar player by the name of Clarence Gatemouth Brown, he had out a song called Okie Dokie Stomp, and I really liked that song, so I would really, you know, get into his playing. Ike and Tina Turner, I got a chance to play on the show with them when I was real young, and so I know that influenced me, just being on the big stage with them. Of course, when we moved into you know, my mother and I working together, she used to always encourage me to sing ballads, the songs that Nat King Cole had made popular, Billy Eckstine, and so forth. Then later on, I think the Beatles had a big influence on music all over the world. But I'd have to say, musically overall, one of my biggest, well, I say two of my biggest influences musically. I have to say one was my grandmother, because she encouraged me so much to play music. She would make me practice all the time, and she was a big source of encouragement. Number two, my mother, who we actually worked together for about 5 or 6 years. That really set me up for what would later on take place with Sly and the Family Stone and so forth. So that was a big influence. Currently, two of my biggest influences and biggest source of motivation when I do whatever I do, wherever I do it, I'll introduce to you right now. One is my dear wife, Tina Graham. And I have to say, she's a big influence. You know how they say about American Express, don't leave home without it? This is my American Express, don't leave home without it. I take my dear wife wherever I go, and I've only left her home in 17 years. I've only left her home two times. Once was for the Grammys, when there was only two tickets available. My manager had to go.
And at least that's what he told me. And of course, I had to be there because I was nominated. So she couldn't go that time. And then recently, we had just got back from New York City, and I had to. I got a message from Eddie Murphy that he wanted me to fly in to play some things on his current album. And so I got a chance to play and do some producing. And I had to fly right back to New York. Well, my wife and daughter were so tired, they just couldn't make it. And so in 17 years, that's the only time that I left one of my influences. My other influence is my daughter. I've only left her once, and that was for that Murphy session in New York. This is another influence. Wherever I go, they keep me smiling, I keep them smiling, and they influence my music and everything that I do. So that takes care of my influences. Yes, the new band is pretty much the old band. I have on drums Gaylord Smashing Bashing Flash. He's so good. And also on keyboards, on B3 organ, which sounded as good as the first day we played, Robert Butch Sam. And then on the other keyboards, we have Herschel Happiness, Herschel Happiness Kennedy. So that covers the keyboard sessions, and they sound just great. And also on guitar, this time we have George Johnson of the Brothers Johnson, and he's throwing down heavy. And also on vocals, we have Mimi from right here in Japan, and she sounds just incredible. So, of course, and myself, and that makes up the current Graham Central Station band, throwing down for you. So we have talked about a lot of things in the last short period of time. We talked about my thumping and plucking, how it all got started, and we really talked about how important it is, the attack. So you got to hit the string. Don't be afraid of it now, just hit it, because the string response is different when you hit it hard than when you hit it soft. Same thing when you're plucking too. You got to snap that baby. You know what I'm saying? That gives it a whole nother sound. So when you put it together, see, so we talked about that. We talked about also the pedals, the fuzz. We talked about my, I call it the Bigfoot, my octave divider. And we also talked about the jet phase, right? And we talked about synchronization. See, so if you take all these things with the up and down, and the left hand technique, and sometimes I'm right. You take all the things that we've talked about, and maybe some things that you noticed that we just didn't get into on this video. We'll talk about that later. You know what I mean? But if you take all those things and put them together, you know what you come up with? Let's see if we can name this. Let's call it the Super Chopper Thumping Plucking Slap Bass Solo.
Super Chopper thumping, plucking, slap bass solo, y'all. Now listen, I want you to do all the things that you've learned in this video, okay? Go back and play it over and over and over and over again. Study it carefully, practice, put all the parts together, and if you do everything I've told you to do now, who knows, you might just cause an earthquake. 1, 2, 3! Yeah.